I'm more fired up than normal because I just saved somebody's life. Wow. That happens now and then, and it just happened again. And I attribute that to what? Just poise, presence of mind, not in a rush, and just an attitude, I guess, do no harm. That is for sure. It just happened out of the blue, just in a split instant like that. Some kid just on a bicycle just completely ran through this red light and right onto a crosswalk. Just when the light had turned green and the traffic was going to go, and I was ready to go, and I see him out of the corner of my eye, and he's just like oblivious to everything. And then suddenly he sees me, he says, "Oh my God, I'm gonna die." And he's just like completely spazzed out. But I, had somehow, something was holding me, to prevent me from starting to go just at the right moment. So he was able to go just right past the front of me. And then he just sailed on like nothing happened, kind of just, lost in space, so to speak. I just like, wow, just that split instant. What was the difference between, him just sailing along like that or just crushing him? It's just so it doesn't matter to me, what people, what age, what gender, what race, what person they are. Nothing of that matters. You just try to just exude, compassion for everyone, equally for everyone. That just may they all be saved from death. May we all be saved from death, which is what we're doing here. We're saving people from death. This universe is a death verse, actually. This world is a death world. The so-called life force is a death force, actually. This whole universe has nothing to do with what we are. Death has nothing to do with reality, actually. It's an attempt to psych out the prime creator, psych reality out and saying, hey, everything's this way. There's no escape from death, ruination. There's no escape. We're trying to convince the prime creator that it too is subject to limitation and ruination. So we do that by putting on this crazy, crazy drama here. It's just a crazy drama. And today, second anniversary of having a mask up. It's been 2 years, and finally, a lot of people are not masking anymore. Like went into a grocery store where everybody had to use the mask, and now, most people are not doing so. Very interesting. It's kind of nice to feel like some sort of return to normalcy, you might say here, irrespective of what. It's really going on in the world, which is the world's just gone crazy, to say the least. I go into KFC. Welcome to the video, everyone. I go into KFC just after I didn't hit this Chinese like high school student. There was just could have been this end, and I was just aware enough to enable him to avoid his folly, to say the least. And I go into KFC, and there's this like one guy there, and he takes my order, and I say, hey, I'm looking around. Said, where's everybody? I said, listen, are you the only person working here? And he says, yeah. I said, what? He says, yeah. I'm in Home Depot earlier on, and ordering something, and I say, can I get some help loading this? And they say, no, we don't have anybody working here anymore. I mean, there's just like very thin staff, skeleton staff. I don't know if I can find anybody. Well, they found someone, and the cashier that was helping me, she went out also and helped. So I had two people helping me. The only thing was is the product was like chipped, and it's no good. And I said, can't take this. And they said, we'll get you another one. So the guy comes out with another one. He says, here you go. And I say, look at it. I say, it's not the same. It's not matching. It's countertops. It's not matching. And he says, no, it's the same. It's the same. The numbers are the same. And I say, well, look at it. I don't care what the numbers say. This got all this rust color. The other one has none. He looks at it. He goes, oh my God, you're right. Huh, how'd that happen? Numbers are the same. And so he says, I don't know if I can find another one. And he later, after a long time, he comes back and says, I found one. And it's like, oh, great. And we're all happy like that. But, just like mistakes are happening. so many mistakes are happening in so many ways. The back of the product was also broken. People aren't working. People are oblivious. You know, it's just, it's the weirdest time ever, actually, right now. It is the weirdest time ever in the history of this planet. It is the weirdest time ever right now. And so, you know, but, and then so I was going to go golfing today after work, and all these screw ups happened and delayed me. And I finally just said, you know what? Forget it. Something's telling me not to do this, because I had this another premonition of don't play, only play once every 7 days, no more than that. Otherwise, you're going to get hurt. And I was trying to squeeze something in there. And I suddenly decided, I said, nope, not going to do it. Not going to do it. Not going to do it. And then suddenly my phone stopped working. And it says, you don't have a SIM card in your phone. Please insert a SIM card in your phone. So I was like, wow, suddenly cut off, you know, canceled from being able to make or receive any phone calls. So I tried then to open the case of the phone. It's a Samsung, it's a Galaxy A6. Couldn't do it at all. There's no way I could open this case up. It's crazy. I tried to figure out how to do it online, and nobody could really help me online. They got some little special tool, or I don't know what they're doing. Couldn't do it. So I said, oh my gosh, I'm in trouble. I need the phone for working. So I just kind of like wham, kind of hit it, like jostled it. Started working. Started working. Now, it's like everything's fine now. But you realize, just like, well, dude, what do I do? I make and receive phone calls all day from work, and no cell phone, and no way to pop the cover off and get the SIM card, maybe it came loose or something. No, where would I take it? I don't know any phone stores around anymore. They seem to like disappeared. So I really didn't know what to do. It seems as though we're just entering this. We've entered a twilight zone. We've really entered into a twilight zone, and it is twilight right now, as we're taping this, actually. And you can feel this twilight zone. But somehow, I'm feeling really positive, because what happened today, I said, just shocked by non-discernible truthing. Wow, I realized that our senses, the eyes and the brain, cannot discern truth at all. Are incapable of discerning truth. We can never discern truth, actually. We cannot. It has to be revealed to us. It's not discerned, but revealed. And I suddenly saw that today. And it's like, wow, so important, incredibly important to see that. So just shocked by non-discerning truthing, wow. Non-discernible truthing, wow. Just allowing non-discernible truthing, wow. Just accepting non-discernible truthing, wow. Just abiding, delighting in non-discernible truthing, wow. Just loving non-discernible truthing, wow. Just abiding in non-discernible truthing, wow. Just non-discernible truthing, wow. Just non-discernible truthing, wow. And so this is huge. This is huge, huge, huge. It just became suddenly clear that our senses can't tell us what is really going on here at all. It's totally ignorant of it and can never be anything other than ignorant of it. The reason I know what's going on, it was not through discernment, but through revelation, a direct revelation from divinity, from truth itself. She just showed me all at once, without my senses. That had nothing to do with my senses at all. It just showed me what's really taking place in this world. But there's no way to see that with your senses. You can never, 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 never actually see that. It has to be revealed. It has to be revealed. So this is why practicing is so important. Putting practicing first is this prepares us for revelation. It psychologically prepares us for revelation. Whereas other people who don't put practicing first keep thinking that they're going to be able to discern truth. You can't discern truth. We cannot discern the truth of this situation. We're completely blind to it. The senses and the brain and the intellect is completely blind to truth here, totally blind, and cannot be anything other than blind to it. Has to come through, has to be revealed to us. So again, practicing prepares us for revelation. Wow. Practice prepares us for revelation. Wow. So we are putting practicing first here. We're putting practicing first. So just confessing attribution, error, continuity, fear, and false hope happening. I need do nothing. I am light. Wow. I need do nothing. I am light. Wow. Just shocked by non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just allowing non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just accepting non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just delighting in non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just loving non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just non-discernible truthing. Wow. This really is like an epiphany, that this is just powerful, actually. And I feel like it's elevated us in the necessary way. It's elevated us to be able to cope with what's going on in the world. This Twilight Zone situation is just non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. Okay, just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow, 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 just keep repeating that to yourself. It's all these repetitions that build up this will, you know, an expectation and willingness to experience non-discernible truthing, to actually experience it, not get a reaction, some discerning reaction, like I'm just trying to discern what are my senses telling me. Let me see if I can discern what they're telling me. They're not telling us anything, really. They're not telling us anything about truth at all. And we cannot get truth in that way. So, yeah. Just so we want to be revelation ready, revelation ready, revelation ready, revelation ready, revelation ready. Wow. Yeah. Talk about something that's close to manifestation as we are migrating towards manifestation-ing. Wow. Just migrating to manifesting. Wow, you might say. Just migrating to manifestationing. You could use that manifestation. Something's manifestation. Manifestationing. Manifestationing. Just migrating to manifestationing. Wow. 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 Okay. Somehow, the closest thing to manifestationing that most of us are used to is like eBay or Amazon or something. You order something and boom, it's there in like a couple days. And this has arrived on Wednesday today, like ahead of time from Winslow, Arizona. I was standing on the corner in Winslow, Arizona. take it easy, don't let the clouds of your own mind drive you crazy. Yeah, this is a shaft for the golf club, and it arrived today. And take it easy, I'm going to take it easy because I'm going to hit a senior shaft instead of the stiff shaft I used to hit. Senior shaft, taking it easy, take it easy, take it easy. Don't let the wheels of your own crazy mind drive you crazy. Hey, let me take this off. So we will put this on here as we just migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. 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 So, you know, it's just, this is like, Made in China, made in China, made in China, made in China. Head is made in China. Shaft made in China. Assembled in China. Fabric. No, fabric, it's all made in China. It's all made in China. But I don't have anything against China. His only problem is the Chinese think that they're in this sense of that they're the greatest in the world. Although maybe the greatest in the world at following, you know, the death force. And, you know, but that who wants to be the greatest at that, actually? So I guess that guy thinks, I don't need to stop, you know, I'm superior to everybody. I could just do whatever the heck I want. It's like, because we had that issue here, the Chinese coming over here and just cutting lines and stores. They just go way up to the front, right up the front. They said, I'm not about to wait in line. That's for slaves waiting in line. I'm superior. Like, so they got this complex. There's no question about it. But, you know, live and learn, you know, they'll die and learn, so to speak. Anyway, I will certainly use this. I got nothing against the Chinese. You know, they're producing a lot of product. And, you know, have a wonderful freedom, wonderful edging past all paranoia-ing for all the Chinese, absolutely. But they are certainly right in the middle of the situation right now, and they don't know what to do exactly between Russia and the United States, right? Things are just absolutely crazy in the world right now. But we're not going to worry about that because we're migrating to manifestationing. Wow. So we have the head here and we have the shaft, this air speeder shaft. It's a beautiful little shaft. Look at that air speeder shaft. Yeah, and it's air speeder shaft. I say, wow, that's nice. And I have to see what I can do here. I can just kind of see if I can put it in here, see if it works. I mean, I don't know if it will or not. Oh, it did. It did. It went in here. So I'm just going to do it like higher standard, lower. I'm just going to put it in kind of like standard, not higher, not lower, right in the middle kind of. Is that what I should do? Or should I go to the higher? I'm going to do the middle, 8 degrees. And so that there it is. Wow. That's kind of cool looking, actually. And I'm going to use this tool to do the tighten up. Hi, everybody. I'm Archie Bell and the Drells from Houston, Texas. I'm going to do a little thing for you called the tighten up. And that's what we're doing right here, doing the tighten up. Is it tightening? I don't know. Does it seem to be? Oh, yeah, it did. Okay. Whew. Okay, now you just have to really torque it. So, we now have officially have this new driver shaft set up. Holy cow. I am just psyched beyond words about this. Ah. Oh. Holy cow. Yeah. Okay. Officially done. It looks great. The club just looks absolutely fantastic. Are you kidding me? Like that. Let me see if I can get this in there. There it is. Okay. I'll let you know soon how that all plays out. That is for sure. Wow. Totally psyched about that. It's like a new chapter. It's like a new chapter. Just when the world gets totally crazy and it feels like we've gone to a new chapter in the world right now. It really feels that way. No more mask mandates here. The way the world's going, it just feels this way. And then just right have this new setup that I haven't tried before, hitting a driver with a senior flex. I don't know what's going to happen, actually. I really don't. But I got a feeling. I can't hide. Oh, yeah. It's going to be, yeah. Okay. So, we are continuing on, just migrating to manifestation. Wow. Just shocked by non-discernible true thing, wow, just shocked by non-discernible true thing, wow, just allowing non-discernible true thing, wow, just accepting non-discernible true thing, wow, just delighting in non-discernible true thing, wow, just loving non-discernible true thing, wow, just abiding in non-discernible true thing, wow, just non-discernible true thing, wow, just non-discernible true thing, wow. This really does feel like we have gone into a new land, so to speak. And this club, this is the same day that Insight comes in, and this setup. Now, this shaft is a very, very, very good shaft, to say the least. Fujikura is one of the very best shafts. They have been for a long time. And this is their lightest shaft, I believe, the Air Speeder. It's called the Air Speeder there. Air Speeder. And A stands for A flex is amateur flex, 45 grams. The 45 is 45 grams there, and then the A is means amateur flex, but that's just a new way of saying senior. You know, they don't want to put a stigma on this amateur flex, so they're using the A now. Oh yeah, there you go. So super, super light, super stable throughout the entire shaft, equal stability, super light, flexible. Kind of nice to be super light and flexible right now, isn't it? And stable. Stable, super light, and flexible. This is what the shaft is. And then the head is a carbon graphite, part carbon graphite head. I think it's maybe part titanium, part carbon carbon fiber head, tailor-made M4 head, excellent head. So I think the combination could just be amazing. It could be amazing, actually. I'll make it amazing, right? I'll make it amazing, yeah. So we're in an amazing time right now, and so we need to make it amazing. We need to just embrace that it's amazing time we're in right now. It's the time, and for us, it's the time of no time. It's the non-discernible truthing time. Wow. Non-discernible truthing time. Wow. Just non-discernible truthing time. Wow. Migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Non-discernible truthing time. Non-discernible truthing. Wow. Migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Whew. Just loving migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Non-discernible truthing, wow. Non-discernible truthing, wow. Non-discernible truthing, wow. Migrating towards manifestationing, wow. Non-discernible truthing, wow. Now migrating toward manifestationing now. Non-discernible truthing, wow. Migrating to non-manifestationing, wow. Non-discernible truthing now. Non-discernible truthing, wow. Migrating towards manifestationing now. Non-discernible truthing, wow, migrating towards manifestationing now. Migrating towards migrating towards manifestationing, wow. Okay, so just shocked by non-discernible truthing, wow, migrating towards manifestationing now. There you go. I'm trying to put them together. See, it's not easy. It's not easy. Non-discernible truthing, wow, migrating towards manifestationing, wow. Just shocked by non-discernible truthing, wow, migrating towards manifestationing, wow. Now, migrating towards manifestationing, wow. Just non-discernible truthing 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 now, migrating towards manifestationing, wow. There you go. So just putting those together. This is just sort of 1-2 punch that we have right now. Just like the head and the shaft now, the combo together. That's what's supposed to be great. They say that the pros, when it comes to would you rather change the head of your club or the shaft, they always say change the head, but not the shaft. The shaft is the most important aspect of it, actually. Yeah. But the combo also is really important. We'll see. Maybe I've hit upon a winning formula. So just shock my non-discernible truthing. Wow. Non-discernible truthing now. Just shock my non-discernible truthing now, migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Just shock my non-discernible truthing now, migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Just loving non-discernible truthing now, migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Just loving non-discernible truthing now, migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Just loving migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Non-discernible truthing now. Just wow. Just migrating towards manifestationing now. Just shocked by migrating towards manifestationing now. Non-discernible truthing. Wow. There you go. Put it both ways like that. So this is kind of like learning to hit a new golf club, you know, kind of thing. It's like if you're not quite got it quite yet, it's like you're working on it. So just loving migrating towards manifestationing now. Non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just loving migrating towards manifestationing now. Non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just loving migrating towards manifestationing now. Non-discernible truthing. Wow. Non-discernible truthing. Wow. Non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just 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 non-discernible truthing. Wow. See, got to keep emphasizing it. Non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just migrating towards manifestationing now. 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 Non-discernible truthing. Wow. See, like that, we're getting a little bit better, right? Even smoothing it out a little bit. Yeah. Another summer day in California. Absolutely gorgeous summer-like day. That's why I say I gotta go out and play golf. But no, I was told don't do more than one every 7 days. Don't do more than that. And so I ended up following the guidance after I got a lot of indications. Hey, things aren't working right. Your phone's not working. You know, stop. Really? So there must be some really strong reason not to do that. Stop me right in my tracks. That's great. So that just shows you that people say that your life is scripted and all this kind of stuff. From one perspective, you know, we could say allow that from a certain types of perspective and approach. But in my life, it's like I'm constantly making decisions between the right path and the wrong path. And it's not set in stone as far as I'm concerned. I was going to break the advice and not follow the advice and say, you know, what could go wrong? But all these troubles suddenly popped up from everywhere. And I started thinking like, hey, there's something doesn't feel right. I feel kind of worried. What the heck's going on? And finally, my phone stopped working. That was the final straw. I was going to go. I was delayed at Home Depot for so long. I said, forget it. You know, I'd be late. And I looked at my watch and said, you know what? It's not too late. Let's go for it. And then I said, I was going to call up, you know, I was going to check the things, the tea times. And I look at my phone, says, can't make phone calls. I was going to call. I said, what's happening? No SIM card. I said, whoa. I can't even let people know what I'm doing. So I said, I better go home. So these things, that's an intervention. So from my standpoint, we're always choosing between right and wrong here. We're always choosing to either to follow the voice of paranoia or the voice of grace that eases us past paranoia. Okay, one of the two. And so are we following our inner guidance, the guidance of grace, or are we listening to our intellect and our senses telling us, what could go wrong? What could go wrong? Well, you know, obviously it must have been something really that wasn't right at all. So I was strongly urged to not play. And I listened to it. But there had been times where I didn't listen and I got in all sorts of terrible trouble because I didn't listen. I realized if I had just listened, I wouldn't have gotten in this trouble. So how is everything scripted, you know? I mean, the grace has to be scripted too then. But again, I always feel like that I have to make a decision. It can't be forced upon me. I have free will. So I can choose delay if I want to, or I can choose not to delay if I want to. So I don't quite understand how the script is written in this context. To delay or not to delay, that is the question, actually. And, I've delayed quite a bit, I would say, in my life here and there, but I've also made a ton of great decisions. But that great decisions were because of guidance that I was listening to. And I said, huh, I wasn't trying to force things. I just said, well, I say, well, let's see what happens. I said, I might play golf today. I don't know. We'll see what happens. And in other words, I'm saying, we'll see what kind of guidance I get. And then I just pay attention to the subtle orchestration of everything around me. What's going on, kind of. Not obsessively, like what are people thinking about me? No, nothing like that. Just what catches my attention? What is like really like saying, hey, pay attention to this or something like that? And then I kind of start thinking like, doesn't seem like this is auspicious. It doesn't seem very synchronicitous and auspicious what's going on. So let me decide I'm not gonna go down that road, so to speak. And I'm gonna choose this road, and then things suddenly lighten up and start getting better and better. You say, oh wow, okay, that was a really good choice to make. So I see it like that. I see we have free will. We have free will. And now there are those who disagree with that, so or put it see it in a different light, and for whatever reason, I can't really say exactly what comment on that too much. I'm just saying from my own experience, certainly we have free will. We're certainly suffering from extreme paranoia. We can choose either to listen to the paranoia or listen to grace that is helping orchestrate our freedom, helping from that paranoia, easing us past that paranoia, which is very difficult to do. Very, very difficult to do. That's our purpose in life. That's why, well, it's not really life. That's our purpose when we want to get free of deathing. This is deathing, not life. When we want to get free of deathing, we gotta ease our way past the paranoia that if we stop pretending all this deathing, we won't know how to function at all. We won't know how, that's the problem. So we have to keep easing our way past this paranoia that if we stop pretending, we won't know how to function at all. So again, I would say number one thing, helpfulness is practice, putting practicing first. And number two is don't use caffeine or any sort of drugs, actually. Don't use any sort of drugs. You have to be in this kind of state. I actually had a dream last night where I was counseling this young person. And the adults, I felt, were not giving them the right counseling. And I said, listen, just kind of sit there and don't feel like you're pushing in any direction whatsoever. But not like you're asleep or comatose or knocked out. Now you're wide awake, your awareness is strong, but you're just not pushing in any direction at all. And just feel where's the breeze coming from? And where is there something that is moving you in what you feel is in a real helpful way? Don't try to force anything. Don't try to force anything. So the problem with like with caffeine is it puts an edge of forcefulness on everybody. It really, 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 really does. And our entire culture, the whole world, 95% plus of people in the world use some form of caffeine in some form every single day. This is the statistics in the world. So that means the entire world, minus 4%, is really has an edge of forcefulness about them. They certainly do. And this precludes you from really just feeling like no push in any direction. But I feel that way most all the time. Just there's no push in any particular direction, really. I'm willing to engage in a direction, but I'm not feeling like I'm trying to force or push myself in any direction. And I just let synchronicity just guide my attention and say, hey, this is okay, let's focus on this, let's get into this or do this. But I'm not trying to really have it. I don't have any idea whatsoever. I don't try to force the issue at all. With caffeine, you can't do that. I remember I had to stay awake. I was driving and I was just couldn't stay awake. I had to drink some Coca-Cola, and or I took some gummies or something that had caffeine in it. I said, and then from that point on, I began just being aware, like a witness of like all these little mistakes I was making. Oh, I forced that. Oh, I forced that. Oh, I forced that. And I became aware just there's all these little instances where I forced things. I said, I don't normally do that. I wouldn't normally do that. I was under the influence of a drug then. Caffeine's a drug and it's subtle, but you become a little forceful here, a little forceful there, a little forceful there, a little. All that stuff adds up. It's like a constant rain. Eventually you get a flood of forcefulness. Eventually you get a flood of forcefulness. So I just said, my God, you know, I felt like I couldn't stop myself. I couldn't like make the right decisions because I felt like I was sort of felt being like pushed. The caffeine was pushing me in sort of a forceful way instead of just this more of just kind of I'm willing to flow in any direction, you know, any moment, not attached to a moment as a means to get somewhere. Okay, not attached to any moment as a means to get somewhere, as a process to get somewhere, and just let grace orchestrate your life kind of situation. So that's what's highly, 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 highly auspicious and helpful. So it would be putting practicing first. Don't use caffeine. Don't use caffeine. Don't use any drugs at all. Actually, they push you in certain ways. That is delay based. That is really hooks you into delay and side trips. So this is kind of a signal of a sort of non forcefulness here. I'm going from a stiff shaft, which you really got to be extremely forceful with. To a senior shaft, which is just nice and slow backswing, and then just hands and wrist kind of just flicking it through like that with your wrist, just a little whoom, like that, just kind of whipping it through like that. But it's not a, you know, brute strength forceful swing. It's a different type of swing. It's very interesting. And so that transition, you know, I'm just like, wow, this is going back in the bag. It's never. I mean, I'm going to have two drivers in my bag. Who has two drivers? Both of them, one's senior flex and one's a ladies flex, which may be even more whippy and flexible. One's 8.5 degrees and other's 15.5. Two drivers like that. That is really cool. With that kind of, you know, flexibility in the driver. Very, very unusual. I never heard anyone have this kind of setup, actually. But it may be a great setup, actually. It may be a really great setup. Especially for these days and when we don't want to be forceful. We don't want to be forceful. We have to feel each moment is unattached as a process to some other moment. And then let the wind of grace, you know, like blow us along like a leaf. Whew, yeah, we're just suspended in this non-forced, non-attached moment. This non-attached moment, momenting. This non-attached momenting, and grace is just moving us where it wants. We're just floating in this non-attached momenting. Wow, non-discernible truthing. Wow, migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Non-discernible truthing, wow. Migrating towards manifestationing, wow. And so my willingness to do this, you know, is just like, it's like, it really just kind of shocked me. Say, holy cow, that's like a very non-macho thing to do. And it's just, but, you know, we'll see. We'll see how it works out on the golf course. You know, these guys are going to be smashing with, you know, forceful smashing. The guy says, "Ah, crazy smash! Whoops, ball! It's going a little bit right." You know, hold on, ball, hold on. Oh, hold on, hold on. Oh, you know, there it goes into the trees. You know, where'd it go? I don't know. Wow. So you know, they may hit it long, and you know, boom, forceful, but the accuracy is just, you know, off they go on another safari. Where's my ball? You know, so it's better to be just hammer it down the middle. But with just the wrist, kind of wrist it down the middle, you might say. Wrist it down the middle. There you go. And just sitting right there, yeah, it's nice and easy. Just nice and easy. So we kind of need to stay nice and easy now, not trying to force anything. As the world, again, has got this edge of aggression. This was going on for a long time. Cigarettes also give you that nicotine, gives you an edge of aggression, but not as much as caffeine, really, but both stimulants, you might say. Caffeine is just like crazy. I just got to stay away from it, especially now, because people are definitely in a state of kind of great concern. Survival is kind of, what is it called, crisis relationships. I could feel this crisis relationship thing where you kind of feel like you want to bond with people in relationships, just someone to cling to, you know, a relationship to cling to. You know, I just want to be surrounded by, you know, relationships. It just, you feel that when things are like this crazy and weird, you know, you just say, boy, I'd be like any port in a storm, you know, it's like and it's just like everybody looks like they'd be a good friend, you know, that kind of thing. So you get into these codependent special relationship things and crises, for sure you do. And this is a global crisis we're in right now. So this, you got to, if you're on caffeine or a stimulant, you're going to start running your mouth off when you shouldn't. That's for sure. And you're going to be more engaging with people than you should, actually, with caffeine. There's a fine line there, you know, to being nice and friendly and being just having an edge of kind of push to the situation kind of thing. And so people are very pushy right now. And driving, you can see it. It's so much pushiness going on. I just say, oh, great, okay, it's fine. Okay, and it's again, everybody's guzzling coffee and caffeine and blah blah blah, you know, taking so many drugs and stuff, and just they have an edge, and they can't back off of that edge at all. But I feel unattached to every moment. I don't feel attached to this moment at all, so to speak. And there's no push in any direction necessarily. So it's that's a savior type of mindset, and I'm saving people from the death force of this death verse. And I believe people can. I've been saved from death many, many, many times in amazing ways. Total grace saving me. So I know that grace does save us from death. There's no question about that. And so we can save one another from death over and over and over. You know, that's a good idea to do. We don't want to have to go through a birth and growing up again and go over like that again. That wastes a lot of time and momentum. It's a momentum buster. I say for death is a momentum buster for us. We want to have a long life, and we just keep on building momentum towards easing past all paranoia-ing, easing past all pretending towards and just migrating towards manifestation-ing, accepting non-discernible truthing. Wow. We want momentum, so we don't want to be injured. Okay, we want to be in great, you know, flawless health, and we want to have long lives, and we want to use that time by putting practicing first, so we don't get a return ticket to this world. We don't get a return ticket here, and you just keep going through the same old cycle, same old cycle, same old cycles, just heedlessly, just listening to the counsel of the senses, you know, and the memories of those senses and stuff, which cannot discern what's going on here at all. Cannot discern. It's undiscernible. Truth is undiscernible. Cannot be discerned. Has to be revealed. So the more we believe in revelation, the personal revelation, the more we prepare for it, the more we practice for it, the more we migrate towards it, the more likely it's going to happen, and the more often it's going to happen, and the more profound it will be. And that's what I've experienced in my life. This is from personal testimony, personal experience. I've had quite a few revelations, and they're getting stronger and stronger, you know, more and more. Wow. So now it's just abiding in non-discernible truthing, as it would be the goal, just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. just migrating towards manifestationing. Wow, just migrating towards manifestationing. Wow, just migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Yeah. Holy cow. I don't know what this is going to be like, man. Wow. It's just, supposed to launch higher. The whippier shaft launches the ball higher, less slices because the club releases real quickly and it's less likely to push the ball and slice it right. And it launches higher. So an 8.5 launching an 8.5 higher with less spin, you know, the combination seems to be, I think, seems to be a way for many people to go, actually. Yeah, not just the seniors. I think probably a lot of golfers could benefit from what I'm doing right here, actually, but they can't allow themselves, you know, to do so. But holy cow. It could work out really, really, really well. I'll take 250 in the middle of the fairway, you know, over 300 in the neck, you know, in the middle of a bunch of trees, you know, every time, right? Every time. And the thing is that people keep thinking like, I'll hit one great, you know, I'll hit one great. Yeah, well, yeah, eventually you will. But in the meantime, you hit just six lousy ones, you know, and you've been struggling, you're getting double, triple, quadruple bogey. And here I am hitting a 250 in the middle on the green, nice pars, easy pars, sailing along. And, you know, it's time to just kind of sail along without doing anything, anything, you know, without getting into too much trouble. We don't want to get into trouble right now. So that course I was going to play today, I've always got into severe trouble there. It's just a trouble waiting to happen. It's a treacherous place. So maybe the Holy Spirit said, hey, I don't want you getting into trouble right now. Okay, I don't want you going into trouble. You know that place is just nothing but trouble. So stay away from it right now. So I did. Yeah, amazing. Don't get into too much trouble right now. Don't get into too much trouble. And to avoid trouble, you know, avoid, I would say, the edge of aggressive edge. Avoid aggressive edge. Or too much of a passive edge, a downer edge, so to speak. Or you get a combination of people who have an aggressive edge and those who have a non-aggressive edge, you might say. Those, that's combustible, those two things. Then you're really going to get pulled into a sideshow. So here we have to have just a synchronicitous outlook. We're neither have aggressive edge nor a non-aggressive edge. We're alert. We're focused. We're willing to move, but we're not attached to the moment. We don't have this moment attached to anything, any particular direction at all. This is the spiritual standpoint. This is where we need to be. It's a synchronicitous attitude. So you get these, you know, like they say, the people on uppers, in other words, they got an aggressive edge, and the people on downers, meaning they got a passive edge or a non-aggressive edge to them, actually. Those two people attract one another. They attract one another very, very strongly. And then you get all the craziness of these special relationships, which we had in the 70s, believe me. I mean, there's always some stuff going on, but there's nothing like the 60s and the 70s where you had pretty much the guys were on amphetamines and the gals were on barbiturates. This is basic Valium barbiturates downers. Usually that was the way. The gals some of the young, real young chicks were taking amphetamines from their mom's cabinets and stuff like that. But the older women, they were more into alcohol and Valium and barbiturates and kind of like this like a passive edge to them. Like, I'm super passive. I'm really just like blissfully passive sort of thing. And then the guys were on amphetamines and they just like had this aggressive edge, like, I can make this happen. I can build a skyscraper today. I can do this. So the combination of those two factors just caused this just an absolute nightmare, you might say, in our culture. And so this is what this guy was telling me, is this ex-con who's super messed up, but, you know, I could see his light was still there, you know. I try to see the light in them, and I say, this guy's going to be a Buddha someday. There's no question about it. So that's what I listened to. I was like, you know what? Hey, you know, future Buddha, tell me something important. And so he did. He told me that don't combine uppers and downers. He says that's a catastrophe. Okay, just don't. That's the worst. He says the worst. Well, he's talking about some profound wisdom here. And so right now, you have women on amphetamines. A ton of women are on amphetamines and caffeine, and they're really aggressive. And a lot of men are passive now, more passive, really, really, really passive. They're on downers, antidepressants, and alcohol, and anti-anxiety meds, and all this kind of stuff. So that they're like have this edge of passivity to them. A lot of guys do. I says, you know, like the Chechnya, head of Chechnya, to talk to, says, Musk, who Elon is going to fight Putin. They say, Ilana, he's such an effeminate man. He's such an effeminate man. You know, to them, they look at Western men, they're so effeminate. You know, they're so effeminate. That's how they view us. and so it's kind of the things have flipped. So it's the women who now have that edge of aggression. The men have the edge of passivity. But it's the combination of those two things is going to be trouble in society and culture. It's going to be trouble. It absolutely is. And that's what that ex-con totally messed up. His life was so screwed up. He couldn't function really effectively at all. He had the wisdom to pass this on, you see. So, he had a positive experience there in some way because you know someone listened to him. I couldn't make out what he was saying or he was talking. He was just gibberish, you know. But I kept trying and trying to, you know, get him a little more focus. And then he ended up saying that jewel. He gave that jewel, you know, of wisdom there. So I know it's just being messed up is just temporary. You know, it's just paranoia. It's just a play of paranoia. It's not permanent. He's going to be just as much a Buddha as any of the rest of us someday. There's no question about it. So I just had faith in him. Like, you know, this guy wants something. I want some coherency from him. I want him to tell me something important. And he did. He did. Really important. Really, really important. Who knows? May have been Padmasambhava, right? The guy said, this guy showed up, you know, he just knew at the job. I mean, he's all messed up, and I don't know if he's going to work out and everything. Maybe it was just Padmasambhava showed up, you know, and just to drop this wisdom, you know, to me. Who knows? It's all an appearance anyway, you know. It could have been. Absolutely could have been. Did a great acting job. We're all doing a great acting job here, actually. So, yeah, you got this combination, a flammable combination, a flammable combination right now. And I'm seeing these guys, these the guys are so effeminate and wimpy, and they're so easily pushed around by women right now. And the combination of the two is just toxic, is so toxic. And they want to kind of be heroes, you know, like ideal heroes, like, you know, that kind of thing. I'm so inspired by the aggression of women. So you go fight, go do this, you know, escalate, you know, push, you know, be aggressive. And the guys are just like saying, oh yeah, if that's what you want me to do, okay, sure, yeah, okay, yeah. But there's you know, wow, there's no synchronicity, there's no alignment with synchronicity going on. You know, they can't say no. I just said, no, I'm not going to play that golf course because guidance is telling me not to. I don't care, you know, who's pushing me to do so. I'm not going to go against my better judgment. So it's like these guys, that like they take the aggressive women's judgment to be like God or something, or goddess. You know, the goddess told me to do this. You know, I want to be a hero for the goddess. That's not the way you're supposed to be. You're going to say, hey, the goddess is all the goddess knows is just a psychological archetype of mandating our attention to cling to false hope and pretending. That's all the goddess really is, and that's all just a useless. It's just something that we are presenting to ourselves to motivate ourselves. It comes from us. We're the originator of the goddess, totally. And she's just giving us bad advice. Taught to cling to pretending. That's all. We don't need to cling to pretending. We're easing ourselves past paranoia, easing ourselves past pretending. So just because the goddess tells you got to do something, just say, goddess, you know, can't always do what you tell me to do. That's all. So that's a real man. You know, real man is flexible, balanced, unattached to the moment. So unattached, having this unattached moment, momenting, and is not bossed around by anybody. Now in culture, I kind of have to play a more passive role because the aggressive male of the 70s, the speed freaks of the 70s, you know, that's no longer in play anymore. I'll tell you, unless the older guys, they still can get away with that with their wives and, you know, that older women, that kind of thing. But but otherwise, though, you can't do that stuff at all. So I just kind of play the fool and just kind of say, oh yeah. But you know, push comes to shove, it's like, no, you know. So yeah, this is just a super combustible situation. Keep in mind, the Fräuleins in Germany were super aggressive because they were the ones that gobbling amphetamines like crazy, Pervitin. Housewives, well, the women were working in Germany. Well, not only the housewives, they were working hard in factories and bringing, you know, they were go. They had to multitask and do so much, and they were gobbling amphetamines. The Nazi youth were egged on by the women, the young women and their mothers and everything. They were like ultra aggressive. They had a super edge of aggression to them, actually, and then the men were just kind of like easily, you know, bullied into that. You know, they just were an edge of passivity to them that was vulnerable to that dynamic. And so we're in a similar situation in the United States, in the Western countries, as a Nazification has taken place, a psychological Nazification has taken place in this country. You got the women being way more aggressive than the men. Holy Spirit's been pointing this out to me for a long time, you know, this, you know, aggressive driving. I said, gosh, that person's super aggressive, unbelievable. What an idiot that guy is. And the Holy Spirit says, how do you know it's a guy? And I said, well, because no woman would do that. And he says, really? I said, yeah. So take a look. I said, well, okay, it's a guy, I'm sure. And it's like, it's not. It's a gal. You know, it's like, what? And the Holy Spirit says, yeah. He says, and let me explain what's going on to you, you know, kind of thing. And I was just like, wow. So it's women are taking more amphetamines than men are now. They're heavily into methamphetamine also. Heavily, you look at the tweakers, like pictures of tweakers. There's so many women. There's so many women there. Women are really into drugs. And look at the gyms, too. You go in the gyms. Who are the most aggressive people in the gym? It's often women. They're just totally into fitness, an edge of aggression. They're totally into that edge of aggressionness. So into it. So many, especially the young women. And that causes the men, it makes them take an edge of passivity. Well, they get in trouble. If men get in trouble if they have an edge of aggression at all towards women, it's essentially illegal in this country to have any edge of aggression towards women whatsoever. In the 70s and 60s, 70s, that was totally expected. Completely legal, totally expected. That's how the dance went then. Now the dance is completely different. And so the guys feel like they have to be passive. They have to be passive. Cannot have any edge of aggression towards women whatsoever. Are you going to find your life ruined right now? This is Nazification of the Western world, actually, is taking place. No question about it. And This is a scary thing. It's a scary, scary thing. As I've said many times, you know, who's running the United States? Women are running the United States. Who's running the White House? Women are running the White House. Who's really behind this war? It's the women's war, actually. If you really dig into it, you'll find out that's what's actually taking place here. We're running on women's rules right now. They have the edge of aggression. Men are look at the president. He's such a passive wimp, you know, that you know, passive aggressive, very passive aggressive guy. And I guarantee you, back in the 70s, that type of guy, we would have just spit on him, you know, I mean, truly. And he was just contemptible. We would have just contempt for this guy. That guy, kind of a passive-aggressive personality. The same thing with 44th president, passive-aggressive kind of personality like that. That's disdainful. We looked at it with disdain, you know. You know, be a man, you know, that kind of thing. You know, stop, you know, doing this, you know, pretense. But he is so easily pushed around by women. It's ridiculous. All his aides are women. These women aides are just like moving around here and here and here and say, read this, do this. And you kind of like, oh, yes, yeah, okay, great, yeah. And then occasionally snaps at somebody, just, you know, just some petty thing, kind of thing. The guy is just a mess, psychological mess, absolute psychological mess. And the women are running the show in the United States, to say the least. They are running the show. The stuff, what's happening in right now in the United States is because of women and their edge of aggression that they have, that they've been cultivating for quite some time. And it's a women's war. It's a women's war that's going on in this world right now. World War III is a women's war, actually. It most certainly is. And you just start looking at the spokespeople and the ministers and foreign ministers and this and this. Every time I look, it's a woman. I say, what? You know, this is like dangerous. This is war. You need men to understand that what happens in war, you know, we try to avoid it at all costs. These idealistic women, they never had to pay the same price as men have in war. You know, they flee the country with their children and they don't get to see all their friends get blown to pieces, you know, in war. So, you know, they are more cavalier about it, you know, more idealistic, like, well, we need to do this, and these people shouldn't be fighting, and we can do this. And the men say, oh, you know, don't say that, you know. So they understand, you know, the dynamics better and how to de-escalate it better. The women don't understand how to de-escalate this situation at all. They're clueless about it. And truly, a lot of women think women should not be in these positions of power and leadership making these decisions, because they say it's going to ruin, it's going to cause a world war. Well, that it has. It has. I know plenty of women who feel that way. They say women should not be in positions of leadership and political leadership, etc. like that. They don't understand, you know, how to de-escalate. They don't understand the you know, how hideous war really is. I mean, they should not be involved in that, actually. Plenty of women feel that way. And they're right. They're right. They're 100% right, actually. So you got, the world has a nightmare on its hands, an absolute nightmare. Very predictable nightmare. So what we do is we just abide in non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. What a great statement that is, isn't it? Just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. So I may be a senior, but that doesn't mean, you know, I can't hammer the ball. You know, I'm just going to hammer it accurately. I used to be able to hammer it pretty good. I was a younger, with a wood laminate club, I hit it over 300 yards. So I could swing hard if I you know, I wanted to. I could hit a baseball a long way. I could do that just for great timing, coordination, and just you know, and exquisite forcefulness, all coordinated properly. It wasn't big and strong or anything, but you know, now it's more important to like hit it 260 right down the middle, so to speak, than to hit it 300 in the woods, and have the averages going, like more consistency, just this non-discernible truthing. Wow, that's like just an incredible statement, isn't it? Just non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just non-discernible truthing. Wow. So the guys need to get out of this passive-aggressive, wimpy-ish thing without going into the edge of aggression-ish, because they can't right now, because they'll get in extreme trouble if they do, cultural trouble if they do. Oh, for sure they will. And so what you want is, you want to go into the synchronicitous condition. So just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. So this is a safe place for guys to go to, for sure. And the gals too, if they want to, you know, back off the edge of aggression without becoming passive aggressive, you know, that sort of thing. Go into just abiding in the abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. Non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. So I don't know how this club's going to work. I just, maybe I'm going to hit it even farther. I don't know. I do feel there's going to be more accuracy. I do feel that way. I do feel it's bound to be more accuracy, you know, and not beat my, I won't beat me up so bad, you know, my wrists and hands and arms and shoulders and hips and knees and everything, back, all that. It just, it won't beat it up so bad. So I'll feel better. I'll feel better, more accurate, feeling better, more consistent, all this stuff. Just, but the, that edge of aggression sort of like is just not there. It's a slower, smoother swing, slower, smoother swing, and just a little burst of speed there, the right point, you know, and just tag it, just tag it. And I was doing that last time playing with the ladies driver and tagged it. And, you know, it went out there nicely. I liked it. It's like, wow, that's some good distance there. It's good distance. It wasn't a, it's not a wimpy swing. It's not a wimpy swing. And it's not a super aggressive swing either. It's a synchronicitous swing. It's a synchronicitous swing, you might say. It's just a non-discerning, truth-filling swing. just abiding a non-discernible true thing. Wow. 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 So I got to stay away from the media and all this kind of stuff. It's at World War III. It's a women's war. And boy, are they playing dirty. Boy, are they playing dirty with the way they're propagandizing everything and the hitting below the belt and emotionalizing it in every last way and all this kind of stuff. I mean, it is just nasty what they're doing. So I just got to stay away from the whole situation entirely, not even look at it. Too dangerous. It's way too dangerous. The propaganda is just flowing like a swarm of mosquitoes, really. Like a swarm of mosquitoes right now. Ruthless, ruthless stuff. The propaganda is more ruthless than the war. That is for sure. If we can even say that, but we can't. As Jesus said, don't fear those that can kill the body. Fear those that can kill the soul, so to speak, meaning your momentum. The purpose of all this war is to kill your momentum. It's just an excuse. They couldn't get away with this kind of propaganda without a war. But now they have a war, this propaganda seems justified. Okay? So they're going after your spirit. They're going after your momentum. Okay? Your spiritual momentum. They're going after your spiritual momentum. And they want to just destroy that spiritual momentum. Okay? But the viciousness of what they're doing, they couldn't quite get away with that. But now with the war, they've got a perfect excuse. They don't have to apologize for their aggression at all. The aggressiveness of women and the way they're propagandizing right now. And they're, you know, subservient, toady men, you know, they're getting away with just extreme, you know, vicious propaganda that's harmful to our momentum, to say the least. And so you just got to stay away from that. They've got the excuse to go there now. They plan to go there, and now this war gives them the perfect excuse to do so. Interesting, just like the health crisis gave certain bureaucratic minds that's the excuse to try to gain control over people, right? They wanted to do that, but they needed an excuse. So here comes this perfect excuse. Huh? And now, oh, here comes this perfect excuse for, you know, vicious propaganda. Ah, gee, how fortunate. I can't let this, you know, opportunity go to waste. Yeah. So the great thing about this, you know, senior shaft is you can swing hard. You can swing as hard as you want, but you're not going to be as wild at all. Not going to be as wild. That is for sure. It's going to be much, much more accurate. Much more accurate. Yeah. So that's a benefit. If you feel like really smashing one, you can say, yeah, it's safe to do so because it's not going to be so wild. Ducks, you hear those ducks? Geese. Or is that geese just flying over? That's interesting. At nighttime? That's quite rare. Wow, interesting. So, yeah, the stuff that the people can get away with now because of this war in terms of trying to bully you psychologically to lose your spiritual momentum is extraordinary, unprecedented, actually, unprecedented. The type of psychological pressures the world is under right now because of the connectedness, the global village we live in and the social media and all this kind of psycho stuff that's going on. They're just going after it, just viciously, just drunk on the blood of the saints is how the Bible put it. That means, getting away with all sorts of means to stifle spiritual momentum is what's going on right here. But we don't have to put up with that. We can just ignore it. Just ignore it. Just ignore it. Don't get involved. Don't get in arguments. You can't win right now. You can't win. Any edge of aggressiveness again towards women right now, you've already automatically lost. Doesn't matter the content whatsoever, the form. You've lost the form of the situation. You're automatically wrong. You're automatically wrong. And you should, because now that, and then the penalty, you become a slave. The penalty is you become a slave. What a nice place this world is, isn't it? That's what's going on. That's why I was told, stop Facebook. Stop Facebook. Don't even tempt yourself to respond to anybody. I'm feeling this mood like, hey, push back against this propaganda. It's time to push back. No. As soon as you push back, you've just automatically lost. You've automatically lost. You're supposed to be passive and be inspired by their aggression, in a direction they want you to go in. Oh, you want me to do this? Sure. Yeah. Most criminals are very passive males, actually. I talked to a guy, he says, just most crime is guys doing stuff for women, what women want them to do. And the guys then do the dirty work, and they do the time. They do the time also. That's how it is in the world. It's pretty amazing. Like a lot of criminals, they're very passive, wimpy kind of men, non-aggressive. Like, it's like, what? But they're easily galvanized into doing the dirty work by an aggressive aggressive women. That is certainly a truism. So we're at that point where there's so many men that are that way in the world. It's just like mind-boggling. They're walking out of the grocery store. There's a couple walking out. They're maybe a little younger than me. And I said, isn't it great that we don't have to wear masks? And the guy says, yeah, I agree, man. It's great. And the woman said, yeah. And they were just like, yeah, it's just awesome. And the guy turned back. He says, have a great day, man. Have a great day. And kind of waved like that. That's very rare to get anything like that. Just a stranger here. Very rare. But he was a more typical male sort of presence, and the one was more typical female sort of thing, where it was okay to have just that slight edge of, break the ice, as a stranger and something, and say something. You're walking out of store together to say, hey, isn't this great? And he said, yeah. And he felt he could respond to me too without any trouble. You see, there wasn't any trouble like that. And so that dynamic there was felt much smoother and more balanced sort of situation actually there. And it was interesting, but I wouldn't have got that from other people necessarily, different age groups and generations, that you they'll be sort of frowned upon, for sure, frowned upon. Especially women. You don't want to say anything to them. You got to wait until you're spoken to, so to speak. You can't just break the ice and just, say something like, look at you, like, what's the matter with you, you're not supposed to do that. I'm the leader here, You're dancing to my tune here. Well, not my generation, that's for sure. And not the Dharma, that's for sure. Not synchronicity doesn't dance to the tune. Dances to its own tune. Synchronicity dances to its own tune. Interesting, yeah, very interesting. Wow, this is so different. The whole dynamic is so different. The whole dynamic is so different. So just stay with synchronicity. Stay with synchronicity. Stay with synchronicity. Stay with synchronicity. Be flexible. Be fluid. Be unattached to any direction whatsoever. Okay, be unattached to any direction whatsoever. Don't let your present momenting be attached to any other momenting. Just sort of be not pulled in any direction. Don't force yourself in any direction. Don't force yourself in any direction. And then just realize that every single person you meet has something like a jewel of wisdom for you. They're all Buddhas in disguise. They're all Buddhas in disguise, for sure. And if you just give them an opportunity, there's some receptivity in the right way, they're going to say something that's profound, that kind of thing. or do something that's profound. If you give them a chance, you give them a chance. Everybody wants to. They're all too scared. They're all too scared. Like, you know, I might get in trouble or something if I'm profound. But if you give them a little opening, say it's okay, profanity's okay here, you know, then they may just drop something, and just say, wow, that's really helpful. So I get helpfulness from so many people every day, actually, just by taking this attitude. I'm listening. I see them. I'm with somebody. I'm kind of serious listening. Say, what do you think about this and this? Yeah. Okay. Listening. I'm trying to see if, you know, if there's some they're going to give me a nugget of information. That guy at KFC, you know, young guy, but I treat him with, you know, great respect. And I said, hey, you know, looks like, I mean, so there's nobody else around. What's going on? Nobody here? He says, no. I said, are you running the whole place by yourself? No. And he says, yeah. He says, they'll be back in a while, you know, but he says, I said, is it staffing? Yeah, staffing is like impossible. It's so difficult. They're all saying that. And, you know, but he's like, I'm saying, wow, that's pretty cool. You're running the whole place by yourself, man. That's amazing. And he says, yeah. And so, like, you know, he could tell that, like, I'm respecting him in a situation, everything, you know, just like that. And I gave him respect for doing that. I said, hey, man, that, you know, I just said, wow, it's just a mess. It's crazy. All the shells were barren too in KFC, like all the front shells, nothing on them. It's like the weirdest thing. It's like the store was not stocked properly, you know. And there's just one guy in a KFC running everything. And Just the whole parking lot dance is getting awkward. People just doing stuff in parking lots. It's all awkward to do. You know, it's just like, what? What are you doing? What are you doing? Okay. People are just acting weird. They're acting weird. Yeah, it's just not normal. So we have to just say, hey, just abiding in non-discernible truthing, wow. Just loving, abiding in non-discernible truthing, wow. Just loving, abiding in non-discernible truthing, wow. Just migrating to manifestationing, 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 wow. Non-discernible truthing, wow. Non-discernible truthing, wow. I need do nothing, I am light, 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 wow. So put practicing first. Don't use the caffeine or the downers. Don't use the uppers or the downers, okay? Don't have an edge of aggression or an edge of passivity. Neither one. Be synchronicitous. So if I pull up at some place, I'm in no too much of a hurry to just rush into the store and everything. I just kind of pull up. I just kind of look around. And just say, what am I noticing here? Okay, this, and kind of get out slowly and kind of stretch a little bit and not be in too much of a hurry. Watch your walking. I caught myself today as walking too fast. I said, walk confidently, but not too fast. This guy I know, I told you before, 65 years old, he plays handball 5 hours in a straight, diving, rolling, everything. And his diet is Kellogg's cornflakes, milk, and bananas. That's it. That's what he eats. It's like lunchtime. I said, what are you eating? Your Kellogg's? His Kellogg cornflakes? Yeah. I said, what is your breakfast? This is my breakfast. I said, all you eat is for a day is cornflakes? He says, yeah. And he's got more energy than anybody I've ever seen. And he's in better shape. He's going to live to be 150. You know, we talk to somebody. I say, he's going to live to be 100. And his friend goes, no, 150 at least. He's a tortoise. So I got some Kellogg's cornflakes today. And as we're getting ready to check out, and I realized I don't have any milk. I haven't drinking milk in ages. I said, how can I eat cornflakes without milk? So I was walking back like to get milk, and I was in line there. And I said, wait a minute, stop walking so fast. Just walk in a sauntering way, but a confident way. I feel I was feeling really confident, to just walk in a sauntering, confident way. Not a like I'm like being pushed, you know, something's pushing me. No, nothing's pushing me. I'm walking in just a, not too slow, and I'm still walking at a nice, good pace, but it was more like a real super confident sauntering sort of thing. Yeah. So make sure you walk like that. Don't walk too fast and don't walk too slow. And make sure, again, you don't get into either of the passive-aggressive, manic-depressive modes of either way. Get a state, get in synchronicitous way of walking and talking. Okay. So, yeah, and just abide, just loving, abiding, and non-discernible. You can say that, just loving non-discernible truthing. Wow, 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 and let the big talkers, let them talk as if they are somehow discerning truth, and they can write books about it. You know, the discernment of truth and all sorts of poetic and beautiful expressions of the oneness of everything like that. It just goes on and on and on. Let him do that. But I'm telling you, we're just loving non-discernible truthing. We're just loving non-discernible truthing. Wow. We're just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. 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 Migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Non-discernible truthing. Wow. Migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Non-discernible truthing. Wow. Migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Just loving non-discernible truthing. Wow. Just migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. Like that, just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. Migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Just abiding in non-discernible truthing. Wow. Migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Migrating towards manifestationing. Wow. Those geese were migratory birds, and they're flying at nighttime. So it means even at night, you can, even in the darkness of these times, you can migrate towards manifestationing. Wow. Migrating 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 towards manifestationing. Wow. Okay, so just do it. You got to practice, because the times, again, the manic passive-aggressive times that we're in is super combustible, super, super dangerous, super, super, super. They're trying to Nazify the Western country, trying to Nazify themselves to get everybody, you know, into the program, on the same narrative, on the same page, following, you know, jackbooted unison of the orders and the directives, which the White House is really run by women. And so it's in this NATO too, the whole thing. And this is trouble. This is extreme trouble, actually. Great, great, great trouble in the world because of all this stuff. Combustible mixture in the world, very combustible psychological mixture. Now, we do not want to mess with it. We want to be very clear, very accurate, very poised, difficult situation, drive it right down the middle, you know, good distance, not, you know, incredible distance, but good distance, good enough for the next shot, setting up, as the guy said to me, that puts you in position A, you know, just right there where you want to be. That's the guy said, I hit the shot, the starter. He says, wow, beauty, position A, man. That's exactly where you want to be, right there. Just put yourself in the right position, okay, by doing that. So that was kind of a confirmation. A starter sees, you know, everybody tee off, and he really liked my tee shot. He really liked it. And he's like, oh, yeah, I like that. That's just right. Just right. Position A, man. Took that right down the tree line, left side of the tree line, and just faded into a slight downhill dogleg right. So it hit and rolled out just like that. It's just perfect. And wow, that's how you do it, man. That's it. And so I said, ah, see, that's good. So put yourself position A, you know, we want to just say, wow, just just abiding a non-discernible true thing. Wow. Just abiding a non-discernible truth thing. Wow. Just abiding a non-discernible truth thing. Wow. Just abiding a non-discernible truth thing. Wow. So it's a very warm day today. It's very warm in the evening here. It's like fantastic. And so this is about enough. I think we've done enough. I got to go cook, prepare a dinner. So if you put practicing first and don't get into either the passive or either the aggressive or passive medications and drugs at all, then you're going to make less mistakes. I'm not saying you're going to hit every shot just right, do everything just right in the world, but your mistakes will not be as bad. They won't be as bad, for sure. You won't double down on them. You'll realize, oh, that was a mistake. Okay, let's just be nice. You know, just kind of thing. Don't double down on them so much. And get back to practicing. And then you'll sort of feel like more stable. When you're stable, then you feel confident you can make right decisions. So just put practicing first. Get off of those drugs as much as you can. As much as you can. Especially caffeine, I think, is the biggest part. Alcohol and caffeine. Get off both alcohol and caffeine right now. Okay. And certainly amphetamines. And get off of cocaine and amphetamines and heroin and all the drugs and pot. Get off pot. That's a very passive drug. Creates massive passivity in men. Massive passivity in men. Pot does. Absolutely it does. That's how guys are trying to, like, get away from any sort of a slight edge of aggression towards women, so to speak, by just smoking pot all the time. They just, you know, become soy babied out, so to speak. And that's what happens. Lowers the testosterone tremendously. Yeah. But then they become, you know, useful slaves is a problem. You know, that doesn't free them from the dynamic of the situation at all. It just makes it actually worse. But boy, you know, when a woman puts you in your place these days, they expect you to just accept that they just put you in your place. But I'm not like that. You know, I just, oh, yeah, well. And they don't like that. They say, what do you mean? You know, I just put you in your place. You just got to know your place, you know. Yeah, you know, it's our turn to put you in your, you know, you, and you know, they can't deal with that at all. They just can't deal with it. They expect to be the leaders. They're the leaders now. They're the ones calling the tune. You know, they're the ones leading the dance at this point. But I don't dance. I don't dance, so to speak. Dance to synchronicity. It's just a super synchronicity dance is all. That kind of thing. So I just kind of stay away from that. I just, just shrug it off and just, don't agree, don't disagree. Just kind of take a neutral stance, so to speak. Neutral stance. Very great. Now I'm going to hit this club. See, it's dark, but I can swing. Can I swing it? Probably. Why not? What's going to happen, man? I'll let you know next video how this went. As for now, that's it for this one. Wow.